Number 13.
Holy Lord, most holy Lord, you alone are worthy of my praise. Oh, holy Lord, most holy Lord, with all of my heart I sing, with my heart I sing, great are you, Lord, worthy of praise, holy and true, great are you, Lord, most holy, Lord.
Holy Lord, most holy Lord, you alone are worthy of my praise, O holy Lord, most holy Lord, with all my heart I sing.
With my heart I sing, great.
How I love the great Redeemer, who is
suffering so much for me. With a joy I tell the story of the love that makes him free. Till my earthly life is ended, I will send him songs of love and beside the crystal sea.
Oh, my Lord, my soul shall be
praising Jesus, Sabbath.
199. Blue skies and rainbows and sunbeams from heaven are what I can see. If my Lord is living in me, I know that Jesus is well and alive today. He makes his home in my heart. Evermore will I be
Oh. 650. 650. After the singing of this song, Brother Barry Fraley will lead us in prayer. 650.
Thank you. bring the lessons and the word here and strive to make this a better community, Father, and for those that we come in contact with each day. Father, we ask that you be with the sick and those that are ailing, Father. We ask that you be with Sam Warren as he continues to recover from this sickness. We ask that you be with Austin Blevins and also Lindsay Merrill, Father. I ask that you be with those three and all those that have asked and interest in our prayers. Father, we ask that you be with Mark Herring as he lost his mother last week. Give him peace and comfort as only you can, Father, in the passing of his mother. And Father, as we go into this worship service, we ask that you clear our minds and open our hearts to take in these songs of praises that we're singing this morning and the lesson that Billy's prepared so that we can apply to our lives, Father. We're so thankful here, Father, for all the things that you do for us, from our families, our homes, our jobs, the talents that you provide us with to provide for our families and to carry out your word to our communities and those that we come in contact with each day. Father, help us to be bright, shining examples each day. In Jesus' name I pray.
Oh,
Tariq. Number 720, Tariq.
Doing things a little different this morning, and you'll see why as I introduce you to the lesson. Of course, we're glad to have each and every one of you here with us today, especially those of you who might be this. I hope you come back. Be with us at every opportunity that you possibly can. Tomorrow's what we call Memorial Day. Interesting thing that we want to remember those who have sacrificed so much that this country might exist. You know, there's a adage, freedom's not free. And it's very true. It costs the lifeblood of many individuals. And so we set aside a day when we can pay our honor and respect to them. But I think I would be remiss if I did not thank everyone in this congregation who has served in the military. Even though you are still with us and present, we appreciate so much what you have done for our country. But when we think about a memorial, it is simply defined as an established remembrance. Okay, that makes sense. And they're actually quite old. In Genesis chapter 8 and verse 20, it says, "Then Noah built an altar to the Lord. And Noah, Abraham, several others in the Bible that we read about, where they traveled about when they went from place to place, they would build these stone altars. They would offer sacrifices there. And those altars would remain as some kind of memorial or tribute to God." And they're throughout the book of the Old Testament. In Genesis chapter 28, after Jacob had his dream of the angels ascending and descending, he lifted up a stone and left it there as a memorial. In Genesis 31, when he is coming back home and he's fled Laban, when Laban catches up with him and they meet and they discuss things, they built an altar there. And they left that altar as a memorial that neither one of us will pass this in anger to go to war against each other. It is said when God gave the children of Israel manna in Exodus chapter 16 that they were to take up a certain amount of it and put it into the Ark of the Covenant, and it was to be a memorial before the Lord. So we see memorials are very, very common. When the children of Israel crossed the Jordan River, and they went into the land of Canaan, they took 12 stones out from the midst of the river. They stacked those up together on the land, and that was to show them where God had allowed them to cross. And it was a memorial to the power and the miracle that God had done. In Joshua 7, we have a Rebbesam memorial. Of course, Achan had sinned in taking some of the materials from the city of Jericho. And he and his family were killed, they were burned, they were stoned, and a pile of stones was put up over them to remind the people, you do not trifle with God. You do not reject the commands of God. And then, toward the end of the book of Joshua, remember, 2.5 of the tribes actually settled on the east side of the Jordan River. They went over, their army and help the people defeat the rest of the land. But as they are crossing back over the Jordan, there was a fear on their part that they might be forgotten. They might be left out, being considered a part of Israel. And so they built an altar. It was an altar that was never intended for sacrifice. And all, when the other tribes heard about it, they were ready to go to war. Until it was explained, we put this altar here so you wouldn't forget about us. So those are some examples of memorials that were a part of the Old Testament. But of course, if we think of Old Testament memorials, obviously the memorial that defined the entire nation of Israel was that of Passover. In Exodus chapter 12, we begin reading there in verse 13. Now the blood shall be a sign for you on your houses where you are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you. And the plague shall not be on you to destroy you when I strike the land of Israel. So this day shall be to you as a memorial. And you shall keep it as a feast to the Lord throughout your generation. By the way, Jews today still practice the Passover. You shall keep it as a feast by an everlasting ordinance. 7 days you shall eat unleavened bread. On the first day you shall remove all leaven from your houses. For whoever eats leavened bread from the first day until the seventh day, that person shall be cut off from Israel. On the first day there shall be a holy convocation, and on the seventh day there will be a holy convocation for you. No manner of work shall be done on them, but that which everyone must eat, that only shall be prepared by you. You shall observe this feast of unleavened bread, for on this same day I have brought your armies out of the land of Egypt. Therefore you shall observe this day throughout your generation as an everlasting ordinance. And so, Passover. When God delivered the children of Israel, they marked their doors with blood. There's a significance here. Please keep that in mind. And so, as they did that, they partook of lamb, they had unleavened bread, they had bitter herbs. It became a very, very important aspect of the nation of Israel. When time came and a year had passed and they're in the wilderness, they partook of the Passover. 2 years, when the tabernacle was finished, they partook of the Passover. One of the very first things they did when they crossed into the land of Canaan is partake of the Passover. It was the memorial that brought that nation. Now, what does all of that have to do with us today? Very simply, because as Christians, you and I have a memorial. It's a very important memorial indeed. And let's go back to our definition, just so we understand. It is an established remembrance. We want to keep something in mind. We want to impress on ourselves something very, very important. To the Jews, it was to impress upon them the fact that they had been delivered by God from the ravages of Egypt. To us, the memorial that we as Christians have reminds us that we have been delivered from sin and from Satan. In Luke chapter 22, beginning in verse 14, and when the hour had come, he sat down and the 12 apostles with him.
Then he said to them, "With fervent desire I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer." And so, one last time, in fact, as we go to the Gospel of John, we can kind of mark the memory and the number of years that Jesus ministered on earth by the Passovers. There are three Passovers celebrated in the Gospel of John. So, Jesus' ministry was a little longer than 3 years. He really wanted to partake of this with them. But the significance of this first statement is, before I suffer. The Passover is about to take on an entirely brand new meaning. Not that people are being delivered from captivity, but that people are being delivered from sin. Not that a lamb is any longer going to be the sacrifice, but the perfect Lamb of God, the precious Son of God, is going to become that sacrifice. Why do I know that? Because Jesus says in verse 16, "For I will no longer eat of it with you until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God." So a significant change is about to occur. Then he took the cup and gave thanks and said, "Take this and divide it among yourselves. For I say to you, I will drink of the fruit of the vine no more until the kingdom of God comes." Now, according to all we understand about Passover, there are 4 servings of the fruit of the vine in the course of the formal meal. It begins with one, and by the way, each one of these has a particular name and designation. There's one a quarter of the way through, one half of the way through, and the final conclusion of the Passover is a partaking of the fruit of the vine. So Luke, the Greek person used to giving details and important material, wants us to see that Jesus ended the Passover formally. We've had this final cup, it's over and done. Then that brings us to verse 19. Then he took bread and gave thanks and broke it and gave it to them saying, "This is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." The very definition of a memorial. Likewise, he also took the cup after supper. Just to make sure we understand, this is not the Passover being brought over. This is something new and different. "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which I shed for you." And so that night, Jesus instituted a memorial for his people. Now, memorial is to remember. You know, we might think within our human minds and our human reasoning, well, I don't really need to be reminded about Christ's sacrifice all that much. I don't really need to concentrate on it, you know, week by week by week by week by week. Why not? Why not? Why not, when God's people come together and we're offering praise to God and we lift our prayers of petition to God, why would we not want to be reminded of the fact that Jesus gave himself as a sacrifice for us? You know, when I was a young preacher, I once heard an adult. Now, I can excuse a little child. But I once heard an adult talking about the taking of crackers and grape juice at church service. And I cringed. I did. This is not crackers and grape juice. This is much, much more than that. I grew up, as you know, in the Vietnam area. I've been to the wall. There are friends that I grew up with that are on that wall. Interesting enough, the first casualty from the state of Alabama was a young man I had gone to church with as a child. Very first casualty. So when I look at those names on that wall, though I do not know many of them, there are names that almost jump out to me. When you go to a national cemetery and you see the markers and you see the individuals who have sacrificed for this country, there is something that jumps out and touches your heart. And so it should. And so when we assemble around this table, when we partake of this memorial, there's something that ought to remind us week after week after week of that amazing, that wonderful, that sacrifice is beyond my understanding that saved someone like that. Now, Paul talks about this, 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 23 beginning. He says, "For I received of the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, Take ye, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." We go to Romans chapter 6 and we understand that Christ shedding his blood, that Christ dying on the cross, allows us to die to sin and be raised a new creation in him. And so we see the significance of this memorial. But Paul goes on. "For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes." Now for some people, they would look at that and say, "Wait a minute. You're talking about Jesus dying. That was a horrible thing." Yes, it was. Yes, it was. Oh, what a horrible thing. That God hated sin so badly that the only cure for it was the precious blood of his Son. But God and Jesus were willing to pay that price for the results that would come. And if you don't understand what I'm saying, go home today and read the 53rd chapter of the book of Isaiah. That chapter explains it way better, by the way, 700 years before Jesus died on the cross. We don't proclaim simply that a man died. We proclaim that a man died for sin. He brought the one time, the all time cure for sin. So Paul goes on, "Therefore, whoever eats this bread and drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body." Now, I'm not about to stand up here and pretend to tell you how you as an individual must partake of the Lord's Supper. There are three common practices among our brethren. I will share those with you. I think any of the three are acceptable. A combination of all three may be fine. Some individuals, when they partake, pray. Thank God for the sacrifice of Jesus. Thank God for what Jesus has done for them. Obviously, prayer is always a significant and important thing. Others, they may have their songbook open to a particular hymn that talks about the sacrifice of Jesus or brings to their mind what the communion is all about. And so they silently read that. There are others who simply just concentrate on the fact and try to visualize Jesus on the cross for them. Whatever best helps you partake of this memorial, that is the one I would recommend for you. But in 1 Corinthians 10 and verse 16, Paul tells us, this cup of blessing which we bless, is it not communion with the blood of Christ? And the bread which we break, is it not the communion of the body of Christ? The word used in communion, translated communion here in the Greek, can mean joint participation in. So when Christians partake of this memorial, by the way, early church called it the Eucharist. The giving of thanks. That's the Greek word for thanksgiving, Eucharist. Communion came to be a word that became more commonly used after Paul wrote 1 Corinthians. We commune with the body and blood of the Lord. Memorials, they're important. Memorials do a lot of things for us. We need memorials. We need reminders. We really, really do. But this memorial puts it all in perspective, Christian. Jesus died for me. Jesus died for you. And once a week, we get to come together. Together, as brothers and sisters, as a family, as part of God's kingdom, we get to come together and remember what Jesus did for us. But as we think about that today, maybe you've never become a Christian. You've never let that precious, precious blood that you shed on that cross wash away your sins. No better time than right now today. To believe in Christ with all of your heart, to repent of your sins, to confess your faith in Him, and to wash away those sins in His precious blood that you found in the waters of baptism. If you're here today and you're an erring child of God, you've got willful sin in your life and you need to get rid of that, again, no more perfect time than that to do so. So if you need to respond to our Lord's invitation today, please come while we stand.